On a winter's day in January of 1820, three fine gentlemen, one of whom was named Thomas Jefferson Beale, sought shelter from the cold at the popular Washington Hotel in Lynchburg, Virginia. Though his traveling companions left around a week later, Thomas stayed at the hotel for the rest of the winter, becoming casual friends with the innkeeper Robert Morris, and hopefully getting a discount on the presidential suite for having the name Thomas Jefferson. 2 years later, in January 1822, Thomas returned to the hotel for the winter and again stayed several weeks. This time, before he left to go west, he asked Robert to keep a locked iron box of important papers for him. Later that spring, Robert received a letter from Thomas, stating that the box contained important papers regarding a fortune belonging to him and some friends. Robert wasn't to open the box unless Thomas or his friends didn't return to retrieve the box within 10 years. If no one came to retrieve the box, in June of 1832, Robert would be sent a letter, which would contain a cipher key for the documents in the box. Thomas did not return to the hotel. Robert never saw him again. The letter with the decoding key never arrived. Robert forgot about the box for 23 years until 1845, when he finally opened it. It contained a letter for him, some old receipts, and three coded documents consisting of a series of numbers. The letter explained that in 1817, Thomas had been the leader of an expedition of 30 gentlemen to the southwest to hunt buffalo and grizzly bear. Near what is now known as the Colorado-New Mexican border, they stumbled upon gold and silver deposits. Agreeing to keep it a secret, the expedition spent close to 2 years quietly mining the precious metals. For safekeeping, they transported their treasure to Virginia by wagon. Two shipments of riches were then buried in a vault near Buford's Tavern, in the county of Bedford, between 1819 and 1821. The three coded papers, which were each encrypted using a different text, explained where the treasure was, what the treasure was, and the names of the explorers and their relatives who would be entitled to shares of the treasure. Thomas was tasked with finding a worthy person to entrust the papers with in case of emergency, which is how he came to ask Robert to look after the box. Unfortunately, Robert couldn't make heads or tails of the encrypted documents. For the next 17 years, Robert attempted to decipher them to no avail. When he was dying, he gave the mysterious documents in a box to an unnamed friend. The friend spent 20 years also attempting to decode the mysterious papers. Using the U.S. Declaration of Independence as a modified cipher key, he was able to successfully decipher the second paper, which gave him a description of the buried treasure. The cipher works in this fashion. Each number corresponds to a word in the Declaration of Independence. For example, the first number in the sentence is 115. The 115th word of the Declaration is instituted, which begins with the letter I, so the first number, 115, represents the letter I, and so on. Excitingly, the second document detailed a plethora of riches. To quote it, "The first deposit consisted of 1,014 pounds of gold and 3,812 pounds of silver, deposited November 1819. The second was made December 1821 and consisted of 1,907 pounds of gold and 1,288 pounds of silver, also jewels, obtained in St. Louis in exchange for silver to save transportation, and valued at $13,000. The document also claimed that the treasure was buried in a vault 6 feet below the ground within 4 miles of Buford's Tavern. From the description, the treasure weighs close to 3 tons and, in today's money, is worth upwards of $43 million. In 1885, the unnamed friend handed off all the documents to another friend, James B. Ward, who published a pamphlet called the Beale Papers. The pamphlet contained the story of the box, Thomas's letters, and decoded second document, and the two yet-to-be-deciphered documents. The pamphlet was sold for 50 cents, or just under $14 in today's money. The pamphlet created a small frenzy and would have sold well, but there was a supply issue. The majority of copies of the Beale Papers pamphlet burned in a warehouse fire. There was little money for reprinting and James died a pauper. The fact that the originals of the pamphlet were hard to get and it was easier to come by second-generation handmade copies of the coded documents added to the allure of the legend. Over the years, people have spent countless hours using a wide variety of significant texts to try to break the two remaining encoded documents, from the Bible to the Magna Carta to Shakespearean plays and everything in between. Others have focused on delving into the background of those mentioned in the pamphlet, hoping that obscure details of their lives will provide some heretofore unknown clue. Fortune hunters from near and far have gone digging both legally and illegally around Bedford. Many people have been arrested for trespassing, fined, sacrificed their lives, and gone broke trying to find the Beale treasure. Famously, in 1898, the Hart brothers, Clayton and George, hired a medium to help them find the treasure. The medium claimed to see Thomas and the treasure during a trance. However, when put to the test, the vision was phony. The Harts spent hours digging the spot pointed out to them by the medium, but found nothing. They even came back a few days later with dynamite, but still found nothing. Interestingly, this failure actually didn't make the Hart brothers give up their search for the riches. They persevered for well over 10 years. Finally, Clayton gave up hunting for the treasure in 1912. However, it wasn't until 1952 that George abandoned hope. Cryptology pioneers Herbert O. Yardley, who founded the U.S. Cipher Bureau at the end of World War I, and Colonel William Friedman, a prominent figure in American code breaking during the first half of the 20th century, were fascinated with the Beale Papers. Colonel William actually incorporated the ciphers into the training program while head of the U.S. Army's Signals Intelligence Service. In 1983, Marilyn Parsons was caught using a backhoe to dig up a cemetery beside Mountain View Baptist Church in Montvale. She claimed to have decoded the Beale Papers and said that she thought the grave markers were an illusion to mark where the gold was. She ended up spending 2 months in jail and paying a $500 fine for trespassing. Luckily for her, a judge dismissed the grave tampering charge. In the late 1980s, a large dig at the top of Porter's Mountain was undertaken with the landowner's permission for a 50-50 split on any treasure found. Nothing Beale-related was discovered, but the treasure hunters found Civil War artifacts. The value of those artifacts paid for their time and equipment rental, so the expedition broke even. Today, there are several online forums dedicated to solving the encrypted papers. Historians and cryptographers have written books on the subject. In recent years, several documentaries and reality shows have discussed theories and hunted for the treasure. As of yet, no one is known to have succeeded in deciphering documents 1 and 3, or finding the treasure. Of course, there's a lot of dissenters who consider the whole thing to be a big hoax. Many people were very interested in the pamphlet, and it was just a poor trick of fate that the majority of the pamphlets were destroyed. Otherwise, James likely would have sold them all and made a fortune. It's pretty convenient that the one decoded document details the huge, amazing treasure. Many people have pointed out holes and inconsistencies in Thomas's story. Would it be possible for a large group of men to mine precious metals for months on end, traveling to the nearest town for supplies, yet no one seemed to catch wind of the fact that they'd found gold? Would it be possible to go into town and purchase 50 pounds of flour and 30 pickaxes without anyone being curious? Then the expedition somehow twice managed to transport several wagon loads of treasure across the central U.S. without anyone noticing. Granted, there were less people then, but there were also Native Americans, trappers, hunters, explorers, and other miners roaming the territory, even when the expedition reached quote-unquote more civilized areas. It's unlikely that a large group could ride into various towns for the night with several covered wagons and no one discover their secret. Why haul the treasure all the way to central Virginia? There had to be safer and easier to travel to hiding places in Kansas or Missouri, etc. Linguists and investigators have analyzed the writing style of the pamphlet and Thomas's letter. Many claim that James and Thomas Beale were the same person because of the similar writing styles. It's also been noticed that some of the words in Thomas's letters are anachronistic. For example, Thomas's letter written in 1822 mentions stampeding buffalo. Stampede is a Spanish word, and it didn't come into widespread use by English speakers until the 1840s. Delving into historical records, a Robert Morris did indeed run the Washington Hotel, but he didn't start the job until 1823. The 1820 U.S. Census records two Thomas Beales, one in Louisiana and a Thomas K. Beale in Virginia. However, records are spotty and the population schedules are missing for three states and one territory. Also, before 1850, the U.S. Census recorded the names of only the heads of households. So, if Thomas was living in someone else's household, he may not have been counted. Several times since the late 1960s, supercomputers have been used to analyze the ciphers. Analysis has found that the ciphers were poorly encoded, and the two undeciphered documents did not show the patterns expected of randomly chosen numbers. Therefore, it probably contains an intelligible text. Cryptographers agree with the assessment, saying that the documents have statistical characteristics would suggest that they're not actually encryptions of English plain text, so either another language is encoded or the text is gibberish. Furthermore, the third cipher appears to be too short to list the names of 30 individuals and their next of kin. One interesting theory is that popular mystery and horror writer Edgar Allan Poe wrote the Beale Papers. He was known to have an interest in cryptography and also used a cryptogram as a plot device in one of his stories. However, Poe died in 1849, 36 years before the Beale Papers were published. Linguistic study has determined that Poe's prose is very grammatically different from the author of the Beale Papers. Other theories abound. Though not much else is known about him, records show that James was a master mason. Some people believe the pamphlet is a fictional Freemason allegory written by him. Other fortune hunters claim to have cracked the code, but the treasure is buried on well-guarded private property, and they cannot get permission to dig. There are some who believe that the treasure was actually found by fortune hunters a long time ago, possibly in the 1880s, not long after the pamphlet was published. Or in the 20th century, the US government or a cabal of wealthy men secretly cracked the code, found the treasure, and removed it. It's also possible that Thomas may have become paranoid, circumvented Robert, and moved the treasure himself. However, many people still believe that an astounding fortune in gold and jewels awaits them if they could just figure out the code. What do you think? Is there really an amazing treasure, or was the Beale Papers an elaborate hoax? Tell us your theories in the comments. Then, go watch How Did a Whole Village Disappear? The Lost Colony of Roanoke Mystery. Thanks for watching, and as always, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. See you next time.